With a question to Dennis. Thanks to the ball throwing yesterday, I got to know that you're specializing in corruption issues and investigative journalism. So tell me if my assumption may be correct or maybe, for example, too harsh on Ukraine. What's your opinion on that? That corruption in Ukraine would be a factor that contributed to the current events. I mean, the annexation of Crimea, the war in the Donbas region. Did corruption weaken the Ukrainian state and allowed it, put it in such a situation in which it is right now?
I don't think so. I'm pretty sure that without corruption, we have more more powerful and more solid country. But most of things you talk about, it's not just economic question. You see, it have a big social and global components. So no, I don't think that without corruption at all, we haven't a lot of these problems. But on the other hand, of course, the part of this problems created and grow up from corruption, because the regions that, okay, Eastern Ukraine, Crimea, it was the most corruptional regions and territories in Ukraine. If we talk about East Ukraine, it's huge, extremely huge corruption with coal, with energy, with its industrial region. Yeah. So of course, if last 20 years we had not stealings, but some improvements of these territories, we have a chance for different situation today. But it's just a chance.
Okay, that was a short introduction, and I will of course have further questions for you, but to Andrei, I would like to ask you to like tell our audience about the current events in Ukraine, what's happening right there, because like a few days ago we had this decentralization discussion in the Ukrainian parliament, and like the protests and the violence that erupted afterwards. And tell us please more about it, and told that these events are taking on civilian population as you are like interested in this subject.
I will begin maybe with referring to this new information which appeared about the petition and the legalization of arms, because after the revolution actually we voted some good laws. And one of the laws was that the Ukrainian people can sign the petition on the website of the president, and if it gets 25,000 of signatures, the president must react, either to express himself or maybe even propose the law. And it actually, this mechanism began to work maybe 2 weeks ago. And it was the first petition, actually, which got 25,000 signatures. And the first petition was that we should legalize the arms. And what is important is that it even got this 25,000 signatures after the events, which happened, so I think, 5 days ago in front of the parliament, when one of the ex, or maybe actual, we don't know, fighters who was fighting in the east for Ukraine state, he threw a grenade and blessed about 100 people, mostly the policemen, and three was killed by the explosion. What it means, first of all, it means that Ukrainian people does not feel that unsafe, and they does not feel that Ukrainian government, that the country can protect them. We don't know how the president will react, but in any case, I think that the parliament won't support this law because they also are afraid of a big number of arms which we have now in the country. And speaking about the current situation, what we must understand. I will speak about my opinion. You can agree or not agree. It is not a civil war, and as Russian authorities says, and it is not the war against ex-miners or ex-tractor drivers who learned how to use the arms and now are fighting against Ukrainian government, but it is the war against Russia. Can Ukraine win this war? I say no, because as the events which happened during this, we have actually more than a year of war, the events, I mean that, for example, when Ukrainian troops begin to win, the Russian government imposes the Russian regular army, and it happened, I think, maybe three or four times that we had really big amount of Ukrainian soldiers who was catch into a pocket because of this intervention of Russian regular army. What is the solution of the conflict? Well, for Ukraine, the solution is not a military, but it lays in two fields. First, it's the deep reforms, and the second is the Western support. But these two elements, they depend on each other. We if we make reforms, we get the Western support, and we cannot make the reforms without Western support. The other question is if the Western countries can somehow intervene in Ukraine with their military forces. I will say no. But they impose the sanctions, and I think that they will continue to do this till the interest of the Western countries is to return to the status quo which we had before the revolution, when Ukrainian government control the eastern territories and the Crimea. What is the interest of Moscow? Moscow does not want for me to conquer Ukraine or to conquer the part of Ukraine. Maybe before it wanted to control the south and the whole east, but now it's too weak and it is suffering of sanctions. For me, the interest of Moscow is to transform Ukraine in some kind of a gray zone between the European Union and the Custom Union. Custom Union, it's the union created by Moscow, and actually it's because Ukrainian people in 2013, they refused to enter this union, and it was imposed by Moscow, and the revolution actually started because of this trade union. And Russian government want to create this kind of gray zone, which will be Ukraine, between European Union and Russian world, as they say. And they want to give for us some kind of Trojan horse, which will be these two unrecognized republics. And we signed Minsk Treatment. It says that we must passed some reforms, and one of the reform is so-called decentralization, and it gives some autonomy to the east to the eastern regions. Actually, it says that the eastern regions will have the special status, and the status will be defined by the law. So for this, the Ukrainian parliament started to change the constitution, but there are some political parties who says that okay, we'll change the constitution. For to change the constitution, you must get the constitutional majority of support, and for just for a law, you must have only the simple like half of the deputies, the simple majority. And they say, what will happen if, for example, the parliament changes, or there will be some other president and government, and they will vote the law which will let the separatists to have the right of veto of all decisions of Ukrainian government. First of all, Moscow wants that the eastern regions could put the veto on the decision in the international arena. I mean, first of all, the membership in NATO. And then they say that if we give special status to the to the eastern separatist region, they will be presented in the parliament, and they will be they will move to Kyiv. So there was a manifestation, and actually, you saw everybody of you saw this video when there was 100 policemen blessed and 3 killed. So now we like. Ukrainian government, it depends on the West, because really strong depends of financial support of International Monetary Fund. And so Ukraine must show that it is a good pupil and it does all homework. Homework is the things written down in the Minsk, Minsk agreement. And if we do all, including giving some autonomy to the eastern region, in such a way the ball will pass to Russia, and Russia will, according to this agreement, Russia must let us return the control of the border, of the eastern border, and if we return the control, it means that we stop the traffic of the arms, and mostly, if there is the control of the border, it will be really easy to win against the separatists.
Thank you. I would like just for a short moment return to Denis, because right now we've heard some things, and one of the most important issues that Andrei touched upon were reforms. And in your opinion, is Ukraine doing good in terms of these reforms, especially in terms of fighting corruption and strengthening its own state, statehood? And another current affair, how do you think the former Georgian president Mikhail Saakashvili is doing in Odessa? Because is it just a PR stunt in your opinion, or is it something bigger?
Oh, he is a funniest person in all Ukrainian politician circles. I think most things Saakashvili talk about, it some kind, on one hand, it's PR, it's presentation. But important thing that his presentations push the government to some change. I think 2 months ago, or maybe 3 months ago, Saakashvili pressed hard on some Ukrainian former officials who chief of Sky Department. I don't know how I can translate it, but it's some officials who chief of department who controlled airlines. And Saakashvili do nothing. He just came to into this department and says a lot of bad things about this guy. And this guy really bad. It's not important for Ukrainian Grand Prosecutor Office. It's generally nothing. But after he came, this official was was eliminated for last 3 months, and he was actually fired just yesterday, I think. So Saakashvili makes a good show, and sometimes this show it's some kind of signal to the government, yeah, because okay. 2 months ago, or maybe a month ago, Saakashvili ruined some walls in private sector in Odessa near the sea. Yeah, it's I think it's first time ever, because these walls and this cottage belongs to Ukrainian oligarchs at all. Yeah, and of course this show. But after that, we have several more complicated situations. Yeah, when. Police and prosecutors really open some territory. So Saakashvili, it's some kind of I don't know guy in the first line. He makes some funny things, but after that, some official things. Okay, we have a possibility to make this too, or even we have to make these things too, because look at Saakashvili. He showed that we can. What about the first part of the question? I'm sorry.
How do you assess the reforms in Ukraine, especially in terms of strengthening the state?
I'm too much optimistic, I think, but today we in Ukraine we have better laws in anti-corruption sector ever. Yeah, I'm happy that I was a small part of movement to push Ministry of Justice to open the registers. Yeah, 2 years ago in our work, we have to base on some insight. Yeah, we have to find people who talk something to us. Today, in 1 year, we have open registry of all companies, yeah, so we can find any companies of someone and and all owners of some companies. We have a law that push companies to show us the final beneficiary, even if this company have some proxy in offshore. We have a great win, because in Ukraine they open a real estate registry, property registry. And in Ukraine today, all officials have to publish their assets declaration. So in half a year, I have several projects. Yeah, we just compared some properties with the assets declaration, and for today we found half a hundred officials with some differences. And today in Ukraine, this difference criminal. So I think in this sector we have very good situation. We have very bad situation with prosecutors, judges, and so on and so on. So we have a lot of information, but nobody needed it.
It's nice to hear some good news from Ukraine. Right now, I would like to ask Tamás Mesercs, please tell us about the current position of the European Union in terms of this conflict. I mean, what does Europe do? what it doesn't and why it doesn't. What actors are we talking about here? Who wants a more strict line with Russia? Who wants to help Ukraine more and why? And of course, the green stance is definitely something worth asking for.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this panel. I'm the least interesting from among the three guys, so I'll try to keep it brief, although this was a handful, so in terms of a question. Let me start, however, with a very brief comment, because being in the Foreign Affairs Committee means that I regularly meet with, for example, NGO representatives from the Ukraine, and actually from all you guys as well. Quite a few times, and what they usually have as sort of the negative claim about the reforms is actually not the laws, but the justice sector reform. And without that, many of the laws will just remain on paper, unless the Ukrainian state is able to produce a system and personnel for justice, that is judges and other legal personnel for the justice system, it is going to be very, very difficult to follow through the actually very good laws that you have already in place. And this is lagging behind. And nobody is really pushing for it other than the civil sector, not even the European Union. It is always mentioned in many of the recommendations, but nobody is really pushing for that. Partly because everybody knows that this is difficult, and partly because there are some of the projects which are more important for the key players in Europe. Now, turning to that, I don't think that Europe, the European Union, or whichever way you try to approach it, has a fully consistent common policy towards the Ukraine, for the very simple reason that Europe or the European Union does not have a fully consistent position vis-a-vis Russia. And the two are inseparable. If you don't have the one, you are not going to have the other, and basically the other way around as well. Whether this is something that can sort of automatically converge into a meaningful policy, I highly doubt. For one of the reasons being that there are different interests at the member state level vis-a-vis both Russia and the Ukraine, and those different interests do play out sometimes in policy debates. Also, and this is not a secret, there are governments in the European Union, governments of member states, for example, mine, which happens to believe that somehow playing back channel to Russia is a productive exercise. It is not. But nevertheless, this is still the official line of my government, which is, I believe, complete nonsense. Now, nevertheless, the sanctions policy which was put in place was surprisingly successful. It is not a very easy exercise, even with a smaller number of interested actors with diverse economic interests. But with the European Union, with 28 members, this was, I think, very close to a miracle. Sanctions policies usually have this tendency to be disrupted because of the differential economic effects on the various actors. It did help, of course, that Germany happened to be in the forefront, and at the same time Germany had the biggest economic loss with the sanctions. So had it been in some other way, someone else pushing for the reforms and someone else bearing the brunt, pushing for the sanctions, and someone else bearing the brunt of the reduced economic exchange, that would have been much more difficult. So this is one of the few cases where I would really think that whatever bad press Germany gets sometimes in the European Union, this was leadership, whichever way you think about it. Now, of course, the whole thing depends on, and this is going to be very interesting as we move towards the deadline of the Minsk II agreement, which is 31st of December this year. And as we move closer to that date, even if we do not have significant military escalation, which I hope we won't have. I very much hope, at this point I don't see any indications of that, but you can correct me on that. The latest information I have is it's relatively stable, at least in military terms. But as we get closer to the deadline, the major problem is going to be the interpretation of how much have been actually observed about Minsk II. And this is one of the classic Russian diplomatic ploys, and this is not even the Soviet ploy, this goes back to the 19th century. And I just very much hope that if the major elements of the Minsk II agreements hold, they might, that actually there could be a real sort of an opening for the way out from the whole crisis. The Ukraine is still in a crisis with all that. And it is not going to be simply resolved by turning our eyes away, despite the fact that there are now more, seemingly more pressing issues at hand in the European Union. It is not going to be resolved by itself. It can remain a frozen conflict, but Ukraine is too big to be able to very long survive a frozen conflict of that magnitude. And this was already too long, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Right now, there will be some time both for your interactions, and I've got questions to you too. Andrei, I wanted to ask you once again about the situation on migrants in Ukraine. What's the human toll of the ongoing conflict? And of course, if you want to reflect on anything that's been said until then the floor is yours.
Yeah, first I want to say that today, for example, we read that Putin says that it's good that Ukrainian government changes the constitution, but Minsk agreement says that Ukrainian government must involve in this process the separatists. So maybe Russia in December, it will play this card you were speaking about. Speaking about migration and not migration, but like migration in the country and internally displaced persons. It's something new that we faced. We have never dealt with such a problem. But because of the war, Ukraine has about 1,400,000 internally displaced persons, but the thing is that they are mostly invisible. If you come to Ukraine, you won't see their some camps like that look like the refugee camps, or you won't see the overcrowded railway stations like in Budapest today. Why it happens? Because Ukrainian government from the beginning it made a big mistake. It put voted the law, and the law says that every Ukrainian who lives in the occupied territories, if he or she wants to get the salary, to get the pension or some other social payments, this person should either move to the non-occupied part of Ukraine, or to get status of internally displaced person. And we had such a phenomena which is called social tourism. The person come to non-occupied territories, receive the status of internally displaced person. This person register somewhere in the houses of some friends, or sometimes it's even some hotels, and then they return to the occupied territories, and they receive all these payments, and they just must come once a month to sign some papers. The problem is that really we don't know what is the number of internally displaced persons. Then we have also the refugees who left Ukraine, and we have about 1 million who is living in Russia and Belarus, and there is a small amount who moved to Europe, mostly it is Poland. And I was looking for on Eurostat the countries from where the refugees come to the European Union, and now Ukraine is on the ninth place. But it gives something like 10,000 refugees, which mostly did not get any status and have to return to Ukraine, because to be a refugee you must prove that your life is in danger, and you cannot prove this if we have peaceful war, peaceful life in other parts of Ukraine. And but even if we are the ninth, still there are much more refugees from, for example, which was a surprise for me, from Serbia and from Albania. I guess there are three Balkan countries and Ukraine among the Europeans, European countries in this top 10. Well, Ukrainian government starts to looking for some policy how to manage these internally displaced persons. And the problem is that it found some solutions, some short-term solutions with international help of international organization and Ukrainian volunteers. Ukrainian government is rather successful in giving some temporary accommodation for internally displaced person, for some social payments. I think that Ukrainian government did not make any step which will give the durable solutions, because in any case we have several hundred thousand people who won't return because we have the social sociology, and the sociology says that there are about 250,000 people who won't return in any case to the eastern regions. And for this person, the Ukrainian government must have some durable solution. If you look for international experience, the experience of Georgia, the experience of Balkan countries, durable solution, it means work, accommodation, access to social services, to public services. And the problem is that it will be very expensive. Ukraine cannot solve this problem alone, because to build the houses, it's very expensive, and to give the job, that the problem is that the eastern region, these are the industrial region, and mostly people from there, they have professions that we don't need in the other parts of the country. So we must start some problems of some programs of giving the other qualification of studies, and for me now, if the situation keeps the same as today, it means that mostly there is no shootings and there is no some military actions in the east. The government won't speak about the problems we have with IDPs, and it will start to speak only before the elections, and elections will happen only in 2 years. Actually, we have election in October, but it's a local election to the local municipalities, and what the parliament did is they voted the law that the IDPs and people who don't have status of IDPs but live in the east, in two eastern regions, they won't have the right to vote. So in such a way, the government don't need to do something for IDPs, and the official reason is that we cannot guarantee the security, And unofficial is that the government is afraid of the result, because before the war it was mostly the pro-Russian voters, and the government don't know how people will vote there.
So I'm returning to Dennis right now, and I've got a question for you. Right now, amongst other problems, Ukraine has also got economical ones. It's in a long-term recession. It negotiates with private investors not to default on its debt. And I would like to ask you, because in mainly pro-Russian propaganda likes to portray like this era of the former president as like caring for common people, and right now this new government is like treacherously right wing and wants to cut social transfers, privatize public services and stuff like that. So what's your opinion on this? How is Ukraine trying to cope with this economic crisis and its social impact?
Okay, let's start from economy. I have to say that last, I think, 8 or maybe 6 years, Ukraine spend much more than can afford. We have two standable course of Ukrainian hryvnia, yeah, and governments spend a lot of money to take this course on one level. We have extremely hard and extremely unclear system of social health for the people, and all this, and by the way, extremely corruption of social system. So all these things have to be clear. We just haven't any other choice at all. Yeah, it. Like a family who take credits and spend more money than their salaries. Yeah, in one day you understand that okay, party's over and you have to pay some debts. So if we talk about this economic questions, Ukraine just tried to manage it in the right way. It very hard, and it very hard for me and for most Ukrainians, because it not the things that upgrade your level of life. Yeah, if we compare any salary with US dollars, yeah, we fall in 3 times. And if we remember about inflation, so we fall in 4 times. That's hard. And in the same time, the government cut some social benefits. Yeah? And that's hard, but that's not bad, because for today we have situation we can pay these debts, or even not our kids, our kids of our kids pay these debts. Yeah, this situation when a community of creditors cancel some part of Ukrainian debts, it helps. Yeah, but it's not forgiveness for everything. So I think Russians media really can joke, make some jokes about this situation, but I believe that this is some steps for the future, because you can't just ignore the situation when you haven't money, yeah? So you can pay from nothing to people. So it's the situation when really government said that, okay, guys, that's hard times, that's really hard times, but we haven't any other options. And of course, this uprise some social tenses, yeah? Because Ukraine was poor country, and that's funny, because 2 years ago, yeah, we can say, yeah, we poor country because our government steal our money and so on and so on, yeah. And we can't even imagine that they steal enough to save this situation for the future. So I think next 20 years Ukraine will pay for their corruption, by the way, yeah, for some high spends and so on and so on. So if you talk about tenses, we have some extremely small percentage of people who understand this. And we have, any politics use this situation for his career, yeah? We have dozens of politics who claims that we must vote for them because governments don't make any good things, and they promise that they bring us to happiness. I think that most part of this social tenses created by this populism, a lot of part. Yeah, that's it.
And just one additional question, just to be perfectly clear. I understand you think that the social cuts, of course, understanding the current economic situation in Ukraine and the whole war issue, do you think, in your opinion, the government is doing it in a right socially just way? Is it sharing the burdens in a good way, or is it just like cutting for the common people and still clinging on to corruption? I've heard some optimism in you, in your opinion regarding the reforms against corruption, but I would like just like to clarify this one.
I want to know that all laws I talk about, yeah, it's anti-corruption laws, but it's information laws. The biggest problem in Ukraine, it's judges. Yeah, we haven't judge system at all. Yeah, it's just some people who takes the money, and we haven't prosecutor system. It have to be totally replaced. So if we talk about some cuts and corruptions. I have to say that for today, the level of corruption lower, much lower than it was 2 years ago. Because 2 years ago, we even want to research the topics with money less half a billion. I have a weekly program. So every week, we have enough information to talk about several billions, yeah. That's about corruption for the future. Today we mostly don't look in public procurement sector. This sector was most corruptional ever, yeah. And today sometimes I even can say that they guys steal something, yeah. Sometimes, yeah, we have some topics, but it's uncomparable with the past. The most corruptional topics, it's it's just justice today. Yeah, that's the biggest problem. And you see, I like to talk about justice. We have some reforms, not information reforms, some hard laws about responsible officials responsible. And these laws really are nothing if any courts can judge someone. Yeah, you can create better laws ever, but nobody need to implement it. Yeah, nobody even read this because you any moment can buy some judges. And a lot of things in Ukraine, I think everything in Ukraine, if you build in your mind some letter, the high step will be justice. If you haven't justice, you haven't anything. If you haven't this right for justice, so you can't ask some policemen about I don't know about good things, yeah, because in Ukraine sometimes prosecutors can't close some really bad things because you can buy a judge. So if we talk about corruption, we still have it, but the sector changed. And if we talk about social cuts, it's not social cuts like a source for corruption. I truly believe in that. Of course, these cuts free some money, yeah, and some part of this money will be still. Ooh, I'm sure of this. But that's not the main reason. Yeah. That's funny that today one of the most corruptional ministry, it's a ministry of social politics. Yeah, that's the ministry which have to regular social politics at all. Yeah, and biggest affairs I read about last 2 months was in social sector, especially if we talk about support of ex-soldiers, yeah? And in medicine sector, in public procurements and in spends, that's the still corruptions. But we can't avoid these cuts, really. You see, system of social support and a lot of other system, like regulator system for the business, like system of sanitary control, fire control, and a lot of other systems, they was created for corruption, yeah? And the main problem in Ukraine, not lustration of some officials, not lustration of persons. The main goals, that's lustration of process. Yeah? Because if you have some, not laws, but norms that are impossible to implement, yeah? Especially if these norms for the businessmen, yeah, they always paying because the government wants them to pay. So the I'm shut up now. But the main goals, it's a clear of justice system, cleaning of prosecutor system, and cleaning of some controls process inspired by the government. That's all. After that, we can cut anything because, any social supports, because we will be sure that this money will be saved. Okay.
And right now, I would like to return to Tamás. We've heard a lot for a need of Ukraine for support of for example, Europe, the European Union, but we of course also talked about that there is no common policies towards Ukraine and Russia, especially during this conflict. Tomasz, please tell me, maybe I'm once again too harsh, like for quite a long time we've heard some, for me, quite interesting ideas for like Green New Deal in Ukraine that would be interesting in terms of like this huge energy dependency of Ukraine with Russia. We've heard about a new Marshall Plan for Ukraine, some investments in future industries that would help kickstart the economy. But we've heard about it and the idea has been right, like quite shut. So do you think more development-oriented policies of Europe towards Ukraine that would not only integrate it economically with Europe, but help it to survive, basically, are still possible? Or is anyone in Europe interested in, or just they're still interested in austerity in Greece and leaving Ukraine in the gray zone, as we've heard?
Again, thank you for the easy question. There are two points that I'd like to make, and I hope that will answer your question, but if not, just tell me. It is one thing that the European Union is spending, in fact, considerable amounts of money on macrofinancial, what is called as macrofinancial assistance to the Ukraine. This is basically for balancing the budget, or at least avoiding immediate collapse of the Ukrainian economy. Now, however, and I'm opening a parenthesis, the Ukrainian finance minister was a very capable woman, managed to negotiate and bring to fruition a full debt restructuring program, which is so far the best that I have seen, not just in the region, but in the last 10 years. So that's a very good program, much better actually than, for example, the Greek program that the European Union pushed through. So at least there is that part of the story, that the debt restructuring is seemingly a sustainable and meaningful project. So this at least dispels the immediate threat of the Ukraine going defunct. On the other hand, what the European Union does beyond this is basically the standard tools that have been worked out in the neighborhood policy, and this is all geared towards what are called the DCFTAs, the Deep and Comprehensive Free Trade Agreements. These Deep and Comprehensive Free Trade Agreements are indeed considerable, they are more beneficial to the recipient country than to the European Union in many important respects. This is true. Getting access to the European markets is maybe a lifeline for some of the sectors in these countries, including the Ukraine. However, what nobody talks about is that these obviously require that amount, that huge economic restructuring within the country. This restructuring, some of the sectors will just basically go bankrupt. Some sectors will basically disappear due to the free trade agreement towards the European Union. But the problem is not that this cannot be offset. The problem is that the social costs will remain local. It will not be reflected in the overall general macro data of the country. Everything would look okay, but there could be entire regions which will lose, for example, an industrial sector. I know that, or at least I can very safely predict that, because this is what happened in many of the East European accession countries after 2004. The macro data are okay, but nevertheless, for example, an entire food processing sector disappeared from Hungary. Now, you may argue that this is good because now there is basically a more efficient distribution of more efficient distribution of the sectors within the European Union, but nevertheless, it created regional social tensions which are not reflected in the overall economic data. And I'm always saying that to countries who are on the road to signing DCFTA now. Most of the Eastern partner countries have signed the DCFTAs, the rest who don't are not likely to sign them in the near future anyway. But this is not, it is almost never mentioned in the European policy debates. And this is something that we care about. And the second part, which I would, of course, need to raise, after all, we are in a green group among green friends. Of course, the energy sector is the key in all of these countries. And what you do with your energy sector, how you redefine the energy sector, how you reroute your energy input, how you get to define much of the economic output and much of the economic activities for the next 10, 15, 20 years to come. And if there is not enough investment in renewables, that is not going to be something that just springs up from nothing. And there is potential in the Ukraine for renewable energy, but that requires part of legislation and part of active support. And this is lacking from the European Union programs, although the DCFTA does pay, I think it's rather lip service than anything else, to the importance of renewables, but the entire energy sector seems to be geared towards basically liquid gas and other sources of energy, which I think are a mistake. That could be a strategic mistake.
Okay, I was asked by the organizers to effectively shut myself for this moment and take the questions to the floor. No, of course I'm joking. So if any of you are interested in the subjects, then please raise your hands and I hope we will try to have some time. Maybe let's take like first two, three questions. Okay, so please come here and ask.
Well, thank you very much. I have a question pertaining to the Ukrainian identity. I recently read an article in The Guardian that basically suggests that what Ukrainian government does now when it tries to redefine Ukrainian identity is suppressing its maybe not Russian roots but Russian component. I mean, in how far is it true? That I would want to know.
Maybe I have two more questions. Who else would like to?
Well, I have two questions. One is what changed after 2 years in attitude of Ukrainian people towards the European Union and towards Russia? And if you have these strong pro-Russian groups now and how they are acting? And another question, as Georgian myself, I'm interested how popular are Georgian politicians in Ukraine and what is public opinion on having Georgian politicians in this government? Yeah, thank you.
All right, who wants to ask? But there was two, but one of those there.
My question is going to be, so how can it happen that Ukraine failed so hard in the beginning and the insurgencies arising in Crimea to not finding any proper opposed to what was happening there? And I would like you to convince me that this is not going to happen again anyhow. I mean, we have a different situation now, of course, with the proper ongoing war right now in the East. But what have to change or what has already changed in Ukraine so that this situation cannot happen again and again in Ukraine? I mean, talk a bit broader about political structures and the military structures maybe even and chain of command and maybe even political culture in Ukraine.
So? who wants to answer this?
Okay, the first question about identity. For me, it's true that, for example, before when you meet some Ukrainian abroad and you ask him if there is a difference between Russian and Ukrainian, he say, yes, I'm Ukrainian, but I'm also Russian, there is no difference. And now it's very different. Ukrainians say that they are Ukrainians. And even Russians, very often, who live in Ukraine, say that they are Ukrainians, and they have nothing in common with Putin, with Russia, and Russian people. But for me, it's not the Ukrainian government who made this separation. For me, it's Russia who made the separation, making a war. All happens because of Russian intervention. For me, it's a myth that there is some strong right ideas, that there is some danger of that the right wing, right sector, for example, will take the power. Yes, they have some support, but they are still weak, and I think that they will stay in this weak condition because they are good as soldiers in the East, but they have nothing to propose in the cabinet. They don't have any ideas. They cannot propose any economical reforms. So for me, it's Russia who makes this Ukrainian identity. The second question about Georgia, Georgian politicians. Yes, they are rather popular, even not rather, but they are very popular because all this time during Yanukovych regime, we were speaking about the Georgian success, that very often the Georgian ex-president and some members of the government were invited on Ukrainian TV. And there were different books which explained why Georgia was successful. And even now, Ukrainian government for example, in the sphere of reform of police, it's mostly a copy of reform which passed in Georgia. So they are very popular, but it's more because of good PR. We were speaking about Saakashvili, and mostly everything what he does, he feels it is put on YouTube, and everybody likes it, everybody speaks about it. But the problem is that people like Georgian politicians, but they don't understand what kind of reforms they did. They don't understand that Ukraine is not Georgia, that Georgia is very small and Ukraine is like 20 Georgias. And then they don't understand that these reforms were liberal reforms, and they will be very painful. For example, today our ex-Georgian president, who is a governor of one of the regions in Ukraine, Saakashvili, today he criticized the Ukrainian prime minister, and the journalist started to speak that maybe Saakashvili begins to his political. To realize his political ambitions to become the head of the Ukrainian government. And yeah, like not only five, but it can happen. Actually, if the situation could be that it can happen, for example, in December. It depends on the situation with the government. But the problem of Saakashvili is that he doesn't have any support in the parliament. He has not his party. And actual prime minister, he has about 80 deputies. But at the moment, Saakashvili does not begin any political campaign for the elections. The more people are disappointed, and the more they don't believe to the actual government, because it does not pass the deep reforms, the more Saakashvili will have the support, and then he can come to the power in Ukraine one day. And but for me, it will be very painful liberal reforms. Like he wants to make, he imagines that he will make Singapore in Ukraine in 2 years. Yeah, but we will see.
Denis, would you like to add something?
Yeah. I just feel more free. Yeah. So about identity and about why it will never be in the future. Yeah, it's the question of Sebastian. Do you know about Schrödinger's cat? Yeah, this superposition where you don't know is the cat live, yeah, or is he died. Before this conflict, Ukrainian identity looked like this superposition. Yeah, because nobody really care mostly. Yeah, Ukrainian, Russians, yeah, it's different, at least, yeah. Most people speak Russians and Ukrainian or on some middle language between Ukrainian and Russia. Some words from there, some words from there. A lot of people have some relatives Russia or maybe in Poland, if we talk about Western region. So nobody really think about this identity. And when you open the box, yeah, you have just one option, yeah, and you see. So this conflict, it was a trigger which have us to decide. So today, really, most Ukrainians came to Ukraine. I think I can say this, and it's a partially. This is a guarantee that without straight conflict, without intruding of Russians' regular army, we haven't some conflicts in other regions, because we haven't a map of Ukraine, yeah, but when this conflict starts, Russian media talk about east and south of Ukraine. If we look to the map, we see just a small part on the east. But all regions near Donetsk and Lugansk, regions like Zaporizhia, like Nikolaev, they was mentally close to Donetsk and Lugansk. Much more closer. They was much more closer than to Kiev or to Lviv. Yeah, it's some kind of associates, and there is no things like Donetsk and Lugansk situation in these regions, because this war, yeah, it pushed to make a choice. So I think that this is the main reason we didn't take a simple situation in other regions. About Georgian politics, I know three of them. Yeah, David Sikorovitsa in the GPO office, it's a deputy of Grand Prosecutor Ukraine. It's Gia Gitsadze, Minister of Justice, and Dizolvava, who helps to create a National Anti-Corruption Bureau. yes, of course, she's present, but I personally never met her. Yeah, I hope we'll meet next month. So I can say that this person's not integrated in Ukrainian government structure, in this personal connections and in some bad black side of government structure. They are mostly free of any bad agreements, and this is great, yeah? That's the reason that they can make a lot, because you can make a lot without some deals, yeah? But it's a guarantee that they can make some right things without any influence, I mean back influence on that. So I'm sure that I'm not sure, because I work in some projects with them, yeah. And if you need to make some good decision, yeah, if you want to push some process in the right direction, the better way today, yeah, communicate with them. And other story with Saakashvili, yeah, because he is funny guy and a public person. But if you talk about people who sometimes integrate in Ukrainian government structure, they are pretty effective. And they really, you see that they live in this shine of good Georgian reputation. Yeah, that's funny, but this effective too. Okay, I'm finished. Thank you.
Okay, I've seen at least. Ah, okay, of course, because there are two other people. There's someone free, I see. Is that all of questions? Yes, because we would need to finish soon. So please answer, then we will get these three questions. I hope they will be a short one and we'll finish.
Yeah, how, such question was how it happens that we lost Crimea without any shooting, and if it can repeat, like, the answer is not clear, but we can say that we lost it because after the revolution, there was not the power, the new power established was not clear, and we lost some connections between Kyiv and the regions. And the other reason is that Ukrainian army was really weak, and maybe the third reason was that there was nobody who could took the responsibility and give the order to shoot. And Ukrainian government and president, they believed that Russia will stop in Crimea, that they will not begin the war in the east, and they were afraid of this. And also there was some hope that the West will react, because we signed this agreement, which by the way was signed in Budapest, when we changed the nuclear weapon for some guarantees. And why won't it repeat now? I think that, but the reason for me is that now Ukrainian people are really, they really prepared for the war. I mean, mentally, and the army which we had 1 year ago, and the army which we have now is really very different armies.
So. Well, maybe among the questions, then you could go with your opinions. Then come here, please.
Thank you. I have a question regarding Hungary and Russia, the relation between these two countries and the governments. For me, it is very interesting, why does the government of Hungary collaborate in some way with Russia and Putin? And how does the population see it? Does the society agree with what Orban is doing? And then another question is, what does Orban gain from working with Russia? And yeah, and does, I mean, the question is, why isn't historically Hungary against Russian idea of spheres of influence? Thank you.
Come on. Please come.
Thanks for the opportunity. I would have a question for Mr. Meserich, and it would be about the fact that the Russian aggression in the Crimea and Eastern Ukraine has presented arguably the most serious geopolitical and security concern for the EU since the fall of the Iron Curtain. So as a member of the European Parliament and a green politician, you have partly shed light on this question, but how do you think that changing to alternative or renewable form of energies would reconstruct Russia's power position in the region of Central Eastern Europe because of their dependence on Russian energy?
There was one more question, as I recalled. Yeah, great.
I'm sorry, I will have to make you talk even more now because this question also belongs to you. It's about the trade agreement. And I think it was speeded up and this was triggered a little bit because of the conflict, which was emerging in Ukraine, and the EU kind of felt the urgent responsibility to push this agreement a little bit forward with Georgia and Moldova, who signed it simultaneously last year in June. And nowadays there are only two persons in the Georgian current government who have been originally worked on the document, and it's a really big document. It's like 1,000 pages, and then the current government is finding themselves in a really funny situation when they come across the regulation or the requirement which they didn't know that they had to meet, and they are super confused. And my question is whether the EU or different kind of EU structures are trying to follow up, or is it only the national responsibility to meet the requirements which are embedded to this document, and how it is, especially in the case of Ukraine, which was even more unclear as well as a process and outcome.
So time for short responses, and we will slowly go away.
Before you slowly go away. let me start at the end, because this, in one sense, this might be the quickest. The Ukrainian DCFTA has not come into force. It will come into force from next year onwards, exactly because the Ukraine still had the largest trade with Russia, and actually having, if the DCFTA has come into force last year, it would have disrupted the entire Ukrainian economy. So it got in this grace period of a year. Now, when, at the time when the DCFTAs were sort of symbolically signed simultaneously in the three capitals, I was watching that actually from Armenia, because the EU delegation to what is called the Euronest Parliamentary Assemblies was having its meeting in Yerevan, and At that point, we had Commissioner Hahn among the speakers whom we could ask questions, and more, not just Greens, not just me, others were also pushing for the simple idea that, okay, these agreements are fine, but are you sure that there is enough state capacity to digest the whole thing? And some of it is there, obviously, but, and I'm sorry for using these highly technical sounding words, but indeed it is capacity building which might help this, if at all. And indeed it might very well be the case that 2, 3, 4 years after the DCFTA is coming into force, governments of these countries would realize some of the targets that they haven't met, but they were supposed to meet, and this might affect their trade, and in fact, in some cases, economic activities very significantly. So this is an urgent task, and the European Union has sufficient, I mean, capacity building is not very, very expensive. It's one of the cheapest things to do, and the EU is relatively good at that. There are reasonably good examples through the previous accession processes, how you can manage that, through what kinds of funds, through what kind of controls. They are not instituted as such at the moment, but I believe that there will be, and they will be, they'll be there very soon. How effective they will be, this partly depends on the recipient countries as well, as we also know from the case of Eastern Europe. The Hungarian government's position on Russia, that's easy for me. I'm in opposition, I'm in an opposition party, so I can simply say that, yeah, they're mad. But to get somewhat more serious than that, they're no longer in active collaboration, so to speak, with Putin, but the official policy of the Hungarian government is still what is known as Eastern opening. And that includes Russia as being a strategic partner, whatever that might mean. This was one of the earliest mistakes of the new Orbán government. They didn't think that strategic partner means something different than significant partner, important partner, whatever. They just used this word casually in international discussions. And this was to the first time when Western partners came to a consternation. Is Russia a strategic partner to Hungary? Now, I cannot vouchsafe for it, but I have a story of why this happened the way it happened. Some of it is very stupid sort of bureaucratic politics. The new government replaced half of the foreign ministry's policy staff 3 times over the last 4 years. One of the major sort of sweeps and beheadings was exactly at the time in last year in April, in April, May, when the Ukrainian crisis turned into the hot issue. This is roughly around the time when the Merkel government changed its mind about its Russia policy. Merkel was hedging her bets up until sometime in mid-April, as far as I can see the story backwards now. And simply the Hungarian government just missed that point. They still believe that they are following the German policy. They are going to be the back channel for Berlin via Moscow. There are important trade and economic relations between Germany and Russia. They're not going to give that up. Therefore, they're going to provide sort of the quasi-diplomatic back channel for that, and that is going to be useful. And it was not until late July that they realized that this is not the case. And at that time, it was too late, and this government is famous for being unable to retrace its steps. It is famous for going forward even more when it finds that it has made a policy mistake. The same what you see out in the streets now. They could have said at any point in time in the last week and a half that, okay, we reconsider our position on the migration issue, should change to this and that. They're just unable to say that. They're not that type of government. Orbán is not that type of politician. As irrational as that may sound, I think that that's part of the story. What was the third one?
Renewables, security, Russia.
That's a big one. I'm not among those who would claim that renewables are the cure-all for each and every problem of the world. I don't think so. But the reason why we support renewables is not primarily the geopolitical reason. Not primarily because many countries in the East are dependent on Russian gas. That's not the reason why we support renewables. The two are slightly separate issues, but I don't want to belittle the story. What happens now is that the gas dependency, which was obviously there even in the year ago, is going to change significantly with the conflict in the East and with Russia being isolated even on the gas market. And the gas market itself is changing, partly due to LGI, partly due to new sources. Genuine world market for natural gas. That has not been the case. Gas was one of the few commodities which has always had a regional market. Therefore, its price and its cost was sort of negotiable within a network. In fact, the price of gas depended on Moscow's decision for much of Eastern Europe. Now, with a genuine world market in gas appearing, this is no longer the case anyway, even without the conflict in the East. So that market is significantly changing, and because these countries are gas dependent in their resource dependency or energy dependency primarily, this changes the story for much of Eastern Europe. We would like to see more renewables for a different reasons, because renewables are the safe bet for the future, and that's good investment. But even without renewables being introduced, that energy sector is changing dramatically as we speak now.
Okay. Thank you. A very warm thank you from myself. I find this discussion very, very informative for me. I hope you have the same opinion as I am. I have. Thank you for our panelists. I hope if they will still be available in the evening if you would like to still discuss the Ukrainian issue. Denis Bigus, journalist and blogger. Tamás Meserich, the Green MEP. Andrei Suvotko from the SEDES think tank,